Miami, the Playboy's paradise. Pretty girls, fast cars. That's just a facade. The bridge separates South Beach from my Miami. The real Miami, the MIA. This is where we hustle.
Every day I'm hustling, 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 every day I'm, every day I'm, every day I'm hustling.
Who you suckers think you're tripping with? Yes, I'm the boss. 745, white on white, that's Rick Ross. I keep them wide, I keep them long, I keep them fat. I keep them coming back, we keep them coming back. I'm in the distribution, I'm like Atlantic. I got them pretty things flying across the Atlantic. I know Pablo, Noriega, the real Noriega. He owe me 100 favors. I ain't petty player, we buy the whole thing. See, most of my homies hustle, they still do their thing. My roof back, my money ride. I'm on the pedal, show you what I'm running like. When they snatch black, I cry for 100 nights. He got 100 bodies, serving 100 lights.
Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm, every day I'm.
We never steal cars, but we hard. Whip it real hard, whip it real hard. I call the charge, I call the charge. Whip it real hard, whip it real hard. Ain't about no funny stuff, still flipping them chickens. I'm on my money stuff, still whipping them Benzes. Major League, who catching because I'm pitching? Jose Canseco just snitching because he finish. I feed them steroids to strengthen up all my chickens. They flying over Pacifics to be specific. Triple C's, you know it's fact. We hold it set. So big and gone rat. Run and tell them that. Mo cars. Mo O's. Mo O's. Mo clothes. Mo clothes. Mo.
Every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling. Every day.
Hey, how's it going, everybody? It's a wonderful holiday I hope you guys had. I'm talking obviously about Trans Visibility Day. Also, it was Easter today. You know, people are upset about the Trans Visibility Awareness Day or whatever. And honestly, I think it makes sense that it's today, March 31st, because it is the anniversary of The Matrix being released, which we all know is an allegory for trans identity. Finding your one self. I don't know. I was basically editing a Renfield video. The Renfield video's happening, folks. I was editing it all day, listening to my stupid voice. And you know what? I thought I should hear my voice some more. Talk, rant to myself about my favorite horror film of all time. I haven't seen it all year. And you know, normally I do watch this movie around Easter or Christmas. No, usually Easter. But yes, The Passion of the Christ. I'm not joking. This isn't an April Fool's joke. I do love this movie. I find most of my movie buff friends, even my friends who are like horror buffs, like so many of my friends just haven't seen this movie. I think they just, you know, heard about what they saw on South Park, and that's good enough for them. And honestly, that South Park episode wasn't far off. You do feel sick to the stomach after the movie's over. But the movie isn't just total torture porn. It isn't just total, you know, like the Hostel movies or whatever. There's some levity, some charming, wonderful moments peppered in there. Lord Toxic is here calling me a blasphemer. Love one another just as I have loved you. Yes, exactly. This is a good movie. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to say... It's funny because like it's like Mel Gibson's best movies, Braveheart, Passion of the Christ. All of his movies are bangers, honestly. Apocalypto, what's it? Forever Young? No, Man Without a Face. Which one did he direct? I think he directed Man Without a Face. He also did, what were the other good ones that he did were awesome? The recent one, the war one, Hacksaw Ridge. That movie was fun. Are you broadcasting from a tool shed? Yeah. Do I sound funny? Am I coming out of the wrong mic? That'd be funny. Let's see. Let's check. No!
Thanks, Toxic. I fixed it. Braveheart. Is the microphone sounding like it should now? God damn it. Well, yeah. I guess let's start over the show. Let's start it over. I'm just kidding. Fuck. Well, yeah. Professor R2 is here. How's it going? Yes, I am broadcasting from the shed. Like I was saying on my crappy microphone a minute ago. I do like this movie. I was editing my stupid Renfield video all day today. I got like a fourth of the way done. And I realized, like, oh, shit, this is going to take some time. And I got to get it done by, like, Wednesday, I think. And hopefully it passes copyright. It might not. I don't know. We'll figure it out, guys. I'm trying to get it out by next Monday. Obviously, tomorrow, bright and early, we're going to talk about GXK, Frozen Empire, Godzilla X Kong, the new Empire. I watched it. I think everyone else did. We got some thoughts about it. It's funny because I did a big, huge Godzilla special just last Christmas. It was a big holiday thing. It was funny. And now here we are on the other sacred Christian holiday, Easter. I'm doing another Godzilla thing. I'm not planning for this to be like this, guys. It just is. And I realized today I hadn't watched this movie in a long time, The Passion of the Christ. Like I said, I try to watch it every Easter. Unironically, it's not like this movie is bullshit. Like we were saying, all the Mel Gibson movies are bangers, and this one, I don't know if it's better than Braveheart or not. I go back and forth. It's also hard to gauge like which one is more fictitious. I mean, they're both they're both totally bonkers adaptations of historical events. Okay, let me just tell you guys. I know Braveheart gets a lot of flack because it's based on some 2-paragraph-long poem, and historical inaccuracies are just flying out the wazoo for that film. But it's still such a good movie that people don't really care. People relate to it on an emotional and human level. I mean, what's more romantic than trying to kill an entire army because they killed your wife? It's a good one. Thing about Braveheart. Mel Gibson, as a director, he really knows how to use slow motion. He uses it all the time. You could argue he overuses it, but I disagree. His movies have this music video quality to them that I think is just epic. And I'm not using that term loosely. His movies literally are epic in scale. Amadeus is 100% BS, but it's great, says Professor R2. Yeah, me and Gordo talked about that at great lengths. Amadeus. I'm wondering if Gordo's seen Passion of the Christ. Has Lord Toxic seen it? Has R2 seen it? I was saying earlier, this movie is one of those movies where, like, all my cinephile friends, a lot of them haven't seen it, especially, like, my horror buff fans. It's like, dude, if you're into horror movies, you should definitely check this movie out. If you're also into Jesus and all that stuff, yes, you should also watch this movie. It's not sacrilegious or anything. It's actually quite a good, it's one of my favorite of all the religious movies, even though it's super violent. It's definitely like a load less sacrilegious than, say, The Last Temptation. Professor R2 has seen this a number of times. Ah, yes. So a man of taste. I remember when I watched this movie. Let me tell you guys a story when I first saw The Passion of the Christ. It came out Ash Wednesday, 2004. I was a senior in high school. You know, believe it or not, guys, this might sound crazy, but I was a bit of a stoner, a hippie kid, marching band drummer, you know, tie dye Birkenstock wearing fish listening to hippie. All my friends were. They still are. I don't know. I was trying to gather a huge gaggle of friends to go see it Ash Wednesday, the day it came out. I was like, let's go. Nobody wanted to go. So I went at lunchtime to the movie theater, bought a ticket in advance for that night around 8 or 9 p.m. This is El Paso, Texas. Okay, so everyone's Mexican. Everyone's Catholic. I decided to go by myself, totally, you know, expecting this, I don't know, Braveheart-style historical movie. First thing that happens, we get in the line. There's like a, this is the old school days. You know, you had to buy your tickets early. Like I said, I had to go to the movie theater that afternoon to get tickets for that night to make sure it wasn't going to sell out. Also, you had to show up like about an hour early to make sure you get good seats. And you knew the movie was going to be popping when you show up an hour early and 100 other people have the same idea. And you're still like number 50 in line. And you're like, okay, this movie's got hype. I see. This movie's going to have legs. As soon as I get into the line, right after me, the people right after me are two women with a baby. I'm talking like 12 months or under. I'm talking a baby. Everyone is looking at these two ladies like, are you crazy? We had all heard the tales. This movie's rated R for graphic hardcore violence. Be prepared. Your stomach may not be able to withstand it. That's what I had heard. That's all I had heard, really. I heard it was going to be super mega violent. It's about Jesus. Okay. Everyone's looking at these ladies like, what the fuck, guys? Seriously, this is a baby. This movie's going to definitely make your child cry. And it was so hilarious because like they're in line for maybe 5 minutes. And this guy in a suit comes up to them. Ma'am, excuse me. We have a policy that no children under two are allowed into rated R movies after 8 p.m. And this Mexican woman flipped her bitch switch so hard. Holy shit, I had never seen anything. She made a fucking full-blown scene. What the fuck is this? I thought this was the Jesus movie, huh? This is the bullshit. You thought of it? It's like, ma'am, we'll get you a refund. We will get your money back, I promise. You can see it some other time. You can take your child to the theater during the day on one of our days. That's a fucking bullshit. I don't want a fucking theater. I don't want a fucking... It was crazy. Everyone is like looking around and like laughing and like snickering and like trying not to... Oh my God, so embarrassing. So embarrassing. So we get seated, right? And this theater is packed. And I'm not saying just packed with people. This movie's packed with fucking children and old ladies and whole families are here, like wearing their church clothes with their ashes on their forehead. Like they just got out of church service and they're going to see Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ. They have no idea what they are in store for. I didn't even have any idea what I was in store for. And then we watched this movie and holy shit. Like I said, I love this movie so much. It really is badass and powerful. Epic and not for the faint of heart. But when this movie's over, you feel like you've climbed a mountain. You know, you feel like you've it's definitely. Yeah, you kind of feel sick. Lord Toxic, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled and everyone who humbles himself will be exalted. This is why I used to caution people when I worked at a theater and I worked in the ticket booth. A guy had partnered with. He used to get pissy with me. I'm like, I'm just saving us the trouble of having to do refunds. Yeah, you know, and to be fair, people were trying to warn everyone. I think most people just assume Jesus Christ. But I knew Mel Gibson. See, I was like Braveheart. That was what was in my head. I didn't realize this movie was going to be like, I'm not joking. It's at least twice as violent as Braveheart, which is interesting because the body count is what? 1, 2, 3? You know, 100 times less than whatever's in Braveheart. Braveheart has so many people dying so bloody. And yet this movie is way worse. I would definitely not recommend it to anyone that's squeamish or anyone that is, you know, a pussy. Like if you're, you know, not everyone's into a Serbian film. Not everyone is into Human Centipede and Kill List and the Terrifier movies. But it's funny because Jesus Christ, the Passion of the Christ movie, it makes it up there with all those sick movies, but it's also up there with Braveheart and all these really good, you know, historical movies. It's definitely the best of all the Christian movies, right? Last Temptation of the Christ was the other one with just came out recently with Ewan McGregor. That one was weird. The one where the devil looked like Obama. That was strange. Did they think Jesus Christ was tickled to death? Well, I think most people thought that he was beaten with sticks. I thought that he just got kind of caned and then put on a cross. The whole chains thing, the hooks on chains, getting whipped with hooks on chains for literally like 30 minutes. That was crazy. Professor R2 says the passion play has a long history. This is merely a very harsh and very realistic take on the suffering and brutality of the last days of Christ. Exactly. Now, here's why I thought this movie blew my mind. Because I was expecting a historically accurate kind of, 2,000 years ago. Fuck no, dude. The devil is in the first scene of the movie. You're like, oh my God, never mind. This movie is going to be off the rails. I'm very excited all of a sudden. And that being said, shit, let's just get into it. I'm going to just go ahead and play this. I know I'm in for a good time. I don't know if it's Mel Gibson's production studio, but it seems like every one of his movies is an icon. And yeah, it's just serious. All right. So let's see. He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. By his wounds, we are healed. Obviously, the movie's got to start with some scripture. Usually movies start with some Bible verse or some quote, and it's not necessary. This one, I feel like it is necessary. And it's interesting because obviously there's thousands of passages you could have picked, and this is the one. Even the passages just directly to the crucifixion. I mean, what? There's got to be at least 100, 200 good ones you could have picked. Anyway, and no, we're not going to break this down super painstakingly. I'm just going to kind of skim through it a bit. But that being said, this movie, I don't know, man, from the very, very, very beginning, we start off in the Olive Garden, and I gotta say, it does look a little movie set-ish, movie set lighting, but it looks badass, and it's Jesus, he's in hiding. That's where we're starting the movie. His last night. He realizes that he has been betrayed. This is all, none of this is mentioned. It's all, you got to know your history. He's on the run. He's going to be arrested soon. He has a traitor in his midst, and it was Judas, obviously. But it's so cool because right off the bat, Kepha, that's the first word we were here, Peter, and they're all talking in, Aramaic. It's, I gotta say, man, so much more badass. This is the movie that made me realize foreign language is so much cooler than, having everyone speak in English in Middle Eastern accents. It just gives it this authenticity. Look at these sleeping bums. That is prophetic scripture describing Christ's suffering centuries before it occurred. Of course. Thanks, R2. Why are you asleep, Kepha? Anyway, he gets really upset because, they're supposed to stay watch. They're supposed to help him. Obviously, day for night usually looks terrible. This movie, I don't know if this is day for night, but it looks like it's day. They shot it to look like day for night, but that's why it looks good. I want to say it's just in a soundstage with blue lighting. I don't know. Of course, you've got this giant fog light in the background. Everything in this ethereal haze. Liminal spaces is what they call this. There's whole Tumblr sections that are dedicated to scenes that look like this. He has a huge burden on his shoulders. They all know that he is... expected to be arrested, betrayed. He said that he was going, that this was all going to happen. And then meanwhile, you've got Jewish, what are they? Priests, high priests, temple leaders giving Judas his silver. And like I said, man, the slow motion, you think it's not necessary, but fuck, it looks so cool. Let's turn off the sound. Woo. This is one of those things where, why are we going to shoot it in slow motion? Just cuz. Judas dropping his silver. Yeah, I mean, he did a bad, bad thing. And he's sold the location, the Olive Garden. This is where he's hiding. The soldiers now know, and they're on their way. And then, like I said, dude, the devil makes an appearance in the first scene of the movie. And it's right about here where you realize, holy shit, this movie's going to be bonkers. I did not realize this movie was going to be a literal adaptation of the Bible, the biblical story. This changes things. And I'm so glad that they did this because it just makes it so much more interesting. I don't care if you believe in Jesus or not. I mean, I'm Catholic, obviously. But even if you don't, it's like, oh, man, you got like snakes crawling out of holes and demons. What's up, Tommy? We're talking about The Passion. I don't know if you've seen it. It's pretty hardcore. But yeah, my favorite screen adaptation of the devil ever right here. You've got some kind of androgynous female model. All right. And, you know, Jesus is praying to the moon, praying to his father. He's looking for strength. And of course, in the distance, we have the shadowy cloaked figure. Now, like I said, this is a female with a shaved head and a man's voice and speaks in Aramaic. And my God, it is so creepy. And also the fact that the devil isn't like this, you know, horned caricature. I appreciate that. The devil's a fallen angel, you know, specifically Lucifer, the angel of music. You're streaming at this hour. Yes, I'm taking a break from my Renfield video. And I figured I should do I didn't do a Sunday Stupenzo stream last week. And I also haven't really watched The Passion this year. So I figured we should just go over it. If you haven't seen it and you're afraid to see it, yeah, you should probably just watch this stream. That'll be, you know, probably a good abridged version. We'll just look at some still frames here. You could probably stomach that. But if you're one of these, you know, horror buffs like I am, I strongly recommend you check out the film. Happy Easter, Stupenzo. Thank you, CLS. Happy Easter to you guys as well. But yeah, let's see. Let me hear this devil speaking for a second here. As a Catholic, I probably should watch this. Yeah. But also, if you're like, you know, not into sick torture porn, you could probably skip it. It's one of those movies where I wouldn't like, it's not like, I don't know, Star Wars or The Godfather. I don't know. There's just some movies where you just don't want to be like, oh my God, you haven't seen this. You've got to watch this right away. Like Forrest Gump, The Incredibles. You could tell anybody, oh my God, you haven't seen The Iron Giant? Oh, watch that. It's amazing. Check it out. You can't just be like, oh, you haven't seen The Exorcist? Oh, dude, you got to watch that. It's not up everyone's alley, just like this movie. This movie is on par with The Exorcist. It's really up there. Let's see. Let's listen to the devil talk for a second. I mean, creepy. Just everything about it is so creepy. And yeah. Awesome. Let's see here. The only horror movie I have seen is Bird Box. So are you serious? That's a joke, right? Yeah, you should get on that. Can't hear anything, by the way. Oh, okay. You can hear me talking, right? let's see. CLS is 100% serious. Well, damn. That's pretty something or other. Here's what I'll do. I'll stop sharing the screen. I'll present again. Entire screen. Check my audio button. Let's hear this devil talk one more time. Let me know if you can hear this. Shelter me, oh Lord. Let's get the... I mean... I don't know. It's almost like kind of like a older looking Rebecca Ferguson type character. All right, Tommy, we're back, baby. We're back. We're back in action. But yeah, like I said, one of my favorite incarnations of the devil in a movie ever because of how understated it is. I think it makes it much creepier. And obviously, like, I don't like how usually the devil is some kind of, usually like a white dude in a business suit. That's usually how we'll depict the devil. which is understandable. I also like the Constantine devil when he walks up wearing that white suit and he's covered in fucking tar or something. That was cool. I also love Legend. Legend is probably my second favorite incarnation of the devil. Tim Curry standing at like seven and a half feet tall with his gigantic oversized horns. The problem is I rewatch Legend and you realize like Tim Curry has such limited emotion that he can depict with that faceplate mask he's wearing. I think at the time I was, you know, you're so blown away by how awesome the devil looks in Legend. But as the movie progresses, yeah, you realize like his eyebrows are static. They don't move. He's always just got this like kind of like smile, you know. But I liked it. I love it. Definitely my favorite unicorn movie. Peter Stormare was awesome in Constantine. Yeah, and you know who else was awesome in Constantine? Fucking Gavin Rosdale, the singer to Bush. Like, first of all, what is he doing in that movie? And why is he so cool as this demon, you know? Finger-licking good. I mean, it's like, I see why Gwen Stefani was having sex with a guy. He has stage presence. I was wondering why he hasn't acted in any other movies. And if he has, you know, I haven't heard of him. Professor R2, oh yeah, you got to go subtle or go all in. Otherwise, it's corny. Yeah, I mean, some of the worst. Who else was a good devil? Viggo Mortensen in The Prophecy. He was a little crazy. Yeah, 100% on Gavin Rosdale. Yeah, hell yeah. Who are some of the like cornier devils? The old lady in the elevator movie, Devil. That movie was so stupid because it was like, there's five people trapped in an elevator. One of them's the devil. It's like, well, it's obviously the old lady because she's, you know, the one you suspect the least, which is why I was shocked that they actually went that route, because obviously they're going to try to pull a fast one on you and make everyone think it's the old lady because she's the most suspected, the least suspectful. I don't know, guys. If you guys have any other good on-screen incarnations of Satan, let me know. I like the Pick of Destiny, David Grohl. That was good. Use the devil's tooth, Pick of Destiny, and then what, the chip his horn off and turn it into the Bong of Destiny. That's stupid, stupid movie. I want to break that down sometime soon. That's one of the better band movies. So anyway, yeah, the devil is let's turn off this audio. Devil's trying to tempt Jesus, yo. It's not cool. And like I said, dude, in the movie theater, I'm talking totally packed. Like, there's not an empty seat in the house. Full of families. Children, like, as young as 5 or 6 years old. Definitely a bunch of middle schoolers and elementary school kids. Girls. Like, little girls in dresses that are, they just left church. They're all excited. And this is the part where, like, oh, it's all quiet now. Everyone's like, what's this all about? They have no idea what's coming in, like, 45 minutes. And I'll tell you guys when we get there. But, yeah, Jesus, you know, he's praying, and this awesome snake scene happens. He stands up, and the devil, tempting him, looks down at his robe, and this fucking big-ass snake crawls out of his... Again, it's just very subtle, but awesome. It's not like a huge effect, and the snake slithers on up to Jesus while he's praying, breaking down, and Jesus, in a shocking move, kind of stands up and curb stomps that snake to death, looks right at the devil, says, no, devil, I will not be poisoned by your ways. I'm paraphrasing, obviously. Jesus gets arrested by these Jewish soldiers. They take him, they're looking for him, and then they find out Judas is the one who betrayed him, and shit gets crazy. There's a confrontation. A big fight. It's all done in awesome slow motion. This whole scene is slow motion for some reason, and it's awesome. And we're going to break down the music in a second, too, because the score to this movie kicks ass. We have a skirmish. These guys, Jesus's disciples, they try to defend him. And one of these dudes gets his ear chopped off. One of these soldiers gets his ear chopped off from Peter, or Kepha, which I guess is... the Aramaic Hebrew pronunciation of Peter. Kepha. It's weird. Anyway, Jesus basically tells them, hey, stand down. Stop fighting. And then he takes some sand and puts it on the severed ear, and his ear grows back. And the guy is obviously freaked out. And the music here is so amazing. And, you know, even though he just had a miracle performed, he still has to help these guys arrest Jesus. And Jesus goes willingly, chooses to get incarcerated. And you can tell this man, he just had his ear removed. He's changed forever. And this is kind of why this movie's good. It doesn't have like your standard, you know, three-act Western story structure. It's got more of an Eastern story structure, kind of like the Odyssey or the Iliad. You've got, you know, a central character who goes on a journey and meets these other characters and, you know, influences them or is influenced by them along the way. And then when he gets to his final destination, it's kind of like reflect on the journey we just had. Gooch, Diabolical Souls is here. What's up? How's it going? Just talking about the Passion of the Christ in the middle of the night. Taking a break from my gigantic Renfield video. Here's a fun fact, guys. The Renfield video is about 5.5 hours long right now. Now, keep in mind, that's including the entire film unedited. So that's about, you know, 1 hour and 45 minutes. And then it's like me talking. But then there's like a lot of like, you know, outtakes and shit that's not going to be used. I'm hoping to whittle this down to like about an hour, but guys, don't be surprised if my Renfield video is like 2 hours of me bitching about that movie. Okay. Cause we know I can go long, but I was trying to go short with it. I was trying to make it like 30 minutes long. I went overboard. And yes, we are talking Jesus. We're talking about, my favorite Jesus movie, one of my favorite Mel Gibson movies, definitely one of my favorite horror movies. I'm glad you're streaming this, Stupenzo. Not many people are keeping today Christian. Well, I think the most Christian thing to do would be not streaming. You know, probably, you know, staying off the computer today. But, you know, it's almost midnight and I was working. I did have a chill day today. I made a salad, ate some chicken and sausage, potatoes and peppers. Chicken, what was it? Chisapapo? Is that what we call it? Chisapapo. Chisapapo. Yeah, chicken, sausage, peppers, potatoes. That's what it's called. And an onion, some cabbage. Just chop it all up. Season it with olive oil and Italian seasoning and salt and pepper and throw it in the oven for about an hour. It's amazing. It's really good, especially with like rice. Anyway, hope you guys had a good Easter. Reminder, go to the store tomorrow. We're going to be streaming on this channel tomorrow around noon, Central Standard Time. We're going to talk about Godzilla X Kong, New Empire. But before that, around 11 a.m., an hour before the show starts, you guys, this is a reminder, go to the store and get your candy. Yes, no Philly Phil. Yes, exactly. I buy the candy on Monday at half price. Well, after sunset, it's technically no longer the Sabbath. Good to know. Good to know that I am not being sacrilegious here talking about the Passion. And also, yeah, I didn't want anyone to think like, you know, oh, yeah, the Passion of the Christ, yeah, making fun of God. No, no, this movie literally kicks ass. This movie's awesome. I can see why this movie, you know, influenced people to like start going to church again and stuff. It's a cool movie, especially the idea that this guy was real. You know, what's the only thing crazier than the fact that, you know, people worship this Jesus guy 2000 years after he existed. The only thing crazier than the idea that we're, you know, worshiping some myth, some character that didn't exist, is the idea that we're worshiping a guy who was real. Like, he literally did come back from the dead, and he literally did do all these miracles. That's way more intense and amazing and freaky, you know. So just I think that, you know, this is one of the few movies ever that really captures that that mythos about it all, that magic. It is magical. It's supernatural, you know. It can't be explained. That movie Noah, for instance, and The Fountain, those Darren Aronofsky movies, to a certain degree, The Fountain, definitely Noah. Those movies are so batshit weird. And they're also not very, I don't know, biblically accurate. Those movies are kind of, yeah, I don't know. It's like a comic book version of the Bible, Noah. That movie's nuts. Gooch saying he's not allowed in churches. Are you talking about the chicken place? See, I believe that. I think every church allows people. Professor R2, Christ follower or not, this movie really should shake you up a bit. Oh, yeah. CLS. Stupenzo, I will in fact be in tomorrow's stream, in the chat at least. Sweet. Hell yeah, dude. If you saw the movie, let me know. What else? Gooch, you hit not one, but 5K while I was gone. Those Arcane videos, the reason. He's too diabolical, he says. Yeah, his animation videos are the tits. I'm going to be talking about Scavenger's Reign every Tuesday. That's going to be for the next, like, what, eight or 9 weeks? So, hell yeah. Anyway, let's play you guys some music real quick. This soundtrack is awesome. And I know, who did this soundtrack, by the way? Rob Allen? No, that doesn't sound right. John Debney? You know, I didn't even look this up. I used to have the soundtrack. I should know, but I'll look it up in a second. But the music, yeah, they took off, he says. Joking aside, this movie is damn good. Good, good. I'm glad that we got people in the chat that have seen this movie, except CLS, but that's okay. I'll say most people I know haven't seen it. Like, I want to know if Gooch has seen it. I'm sorry, Gordo. I want to know if Gordo's seen it. I'm pretty sure he has. I definitely want to know if Vex and Uninspired Reviewer have seen it, because those guys are big horror buffs. So it's like, I can't tell you how many, like, goth friends I know that are, like, I don't know, super into Marilyn Manson and shit. I haven't seen this movie. It's like, bro, you should check it out. Because even if you're, like, you know, not into Jesus, even if you watch this movie ironically because you're, like, a Satanist, it's still probably pretty damn entertaining. This movie's nuts. I've never seen anything like it. I'm not joking. And I never, ever, ever had a theater react to this movie, to a movie like I saw this movie. This is what I'll get into in a second. Stupenzo, I will get the Uninspired Reviewer to watch it if he hasn't. I want to do something with him. Oh, my God. Don't watch that movie. You should watch that movie by yourself in solitude, in silence. I don't think you should watch that movie with, like, popcorn and buddies. To be fair, after I did see this movie, I did go see it in theaters a couple more times, and I did convince some friends to go see it with me. And we drank a bunch of Carlo Rossi wine, and we went into the theater, and yeah, there was a point halfway into the movie where my friend Carrie, he looked at me, and I was, like, smiling at him, and everyone in the theater is, like, screaming, you know, and he's looking at me like, you son of a bitch, why did you bring us here? Why did you bring us here? What is this? Good times, man. I was 18. Yep. Had the whole world ahead of me. So, yeah, let's play some of the soundtrack for a second here. This is when Jesus gets arrested here. This music, I know it might be, like, stereotypically ethnic, but I don't care. This stuff is badass. Now, let's see. I'm pretty sure I can get away with playing this. Sounds like a coyote or something. Oh, yeah. Now bring in the whistles. It's awesome. It's awesome. The soundtrack's great. It's probably one, if not my favorite part about the whole movie. Now, obviously, the production design is fantastic. The costumes are amazing. This movie is one of those great examples of really, like, putting you in the world. And I say it again, it's mostly because of the authentic language. You have to understand, this movie came out the same year as fucking gay-ass Memoirs of a Geisha came out. And like, hearing these Chinese actors, like, speak in broken English was so distracting. And I remember, like, I had already seen The Passion, and I was like, why aren't they just speaking in Chinese? Or is it Japanese? Geisha's Chinese or Japanese? I can't remember. Japanese? Seems Japanese. The point is, like, yeah, don't be singing in broken English, talking in broken English. It'd be so much better just talking in the native dialect. And again, Apocalypto came out a short while after this. And again, native language. It just makes the movie so, like, visceral. Japanese. Thank you, R2. I knew. I figured it was Japanese because it ends in an A. You know, all these Japanese words end in vowels. So, yeah. Anyway, continuing on with the film, we'll skip it along here for a bit. Jesus gets arrested and immediately starts getting the shit beaten out of him. And we've got Monica Bellucci, one of my favorite on-screen Bettys. I like them girls tall, dark, and handsome. You know what I mean? The two Marys are, they're troubled. Jesus's other brother shows up and, or disciple shows up and tells them, hey, he's been arrested. It's not looking good. Kepha basically, rubbing it in. Now, this is where it starts getting off the rails immediately. Like, they're not just like arresting him. They're like punching him in the face. And they throw him off of this this bridge, and he's hung by chains. And you hear his like hips basically almost break. It's really bad. Just punch him and throw him overboard, and it's so violent. And he just happens to fall right in front of Judas himself. There he is, getting startled. Now here's a feel good movie, says Adam Gray. Honestly, it kind of is. I'm not joking. This movie does a great job of peppering in a lot of levity where it's needed. And granted, the movie does kind of, you feel drained at the end of the movie, but it does end on a high note. And there are a lot of really good, like, these flashback scenes make the movie worth watching. So it's not just all disturbing gore porn. But yes, Judas is being tormented. He's being tormented with his crime of betraying his savior. Jesus then gets like startled by one of the creepiest looking demons I've ever seen. Now this movie is peppered with demons and they all look horrifying. Jesus gets hoisted back up by those chains, and Judas hears a little noise, a little growling noise. Let's see what it is. What is that over there? What is that? I'm going to try to get a frame of that. It's one of the freakiest looking demons ever. And apparently there was a cool prosthetic for it. It's the white man's Apocalypto. Well, I'm a white dude and I liked Apocalypto. Apocalypto is fantastic because the movie starts off with a bunch of naked dudes in the jungle eating boar balls, like eating raw boar testicles. That's the first thing that we're seeing in the movie. And I remember the audience is like laughing and kind of like, what the hell is this? And then by the end of the movie, the entire theater is like, run, Jaguar Paw, go save your family. Everyone is totally invested in all these naked jungle people. Does a really good job of making you relate to these people that you didn't think you'd relate to. Kind of the beauty of storytelling, isn't it? Let's see if I can get a picture of this damn demon from hell. Where is it? Show it to me. Blah. I mean, what the hell, guys? We are 10 minutes into the movie. All right. So we've already met the devil, seen a demon. I say this movie's 10 minutes in, and it's been 5 minutes of slow motion. This movie is style and substance. Really good at setting the tone. And holy fuck, dude, that's a freaky looking demon. Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. Everything about it. Yeah, I remember that shit got a legit like scare out of everybody. It scared the shit out of me in the theater. You know, like I said, we thought we were going to go see some historical Jesus movie. I didn't realize we were going to watch like one of the scariest movies ever made. So yeah. Dude's going around telling everyone they've caught Jesus. They're going to do a trial in the middle of the night, without all the councilmen, the priests, everyone's, it's a very slapdashed, improvised kind of event. Everyone, it's very out of the ordinary. He's basically a war criminal, you know. Adam Gray says that demon wants to tell you about the time he owned a comic shop. Yeah. Let's see. Oh my God. Keep it in full screen, gentlemen. Yeah, Judas is there. Everyone's there. They're going to give him the old, they're going to give him the old Donald Trump treatment. You're guilty no matter what, right? Now, this is one of my favorite parts of the movie. All the shit that's in Latin. There's a gigantic language shift right here with these Roman guards. And I gotta say, damn it, this is why like Italian's like the sexiest language ever. It's derived from this. And granted, all these Latin-based languages. But it's like, up until then, we've been hearing nothing but Hebrew and Aramaic. All the devil stuff is Aramaic. Stupenzo, you don't sound like a robot when you read messages tonight. Great job. Stupenzo, you don't sound like a robot when you read messages tonight. Great job. Cool. Thank you. Monica Bellucci trying to tell them, hey, this isn't right. They've arrested Jesus of Nazareth. And this guy, this guard is like, no, they haven't. Shut up, silly woman. Don't listen to them. These guards are like kind of like troubled by that because apparently it's a big problem if it is a controversial character. This is Sanhedrin, basically a Supreme Court of Israel under Jewish law, says Professor R2, dropping in all the knowledge. Hell yeah. Adam Gray, chicks dig Aramaic. Oh, yeah, you weren't there for that joke. Never mind. Sorry. Yeah, people are joking about me when I'm not there. That's always good to know that I'm on people's minds. And yeah, sometimes I do like to read like a robot. I'll promise to emote more. Let's see here. This is where the language shift happens. And my God, this Latin, it's like music to the ears.
Melius nobis eunum est, disfunctiandum quod molestia objecit.
Ah. Que musica, que bella. Yeah, I don't know. There's three languages in this movie, and all the Latin parts are so, like, I don't know, epic. I'm going to keep saying that. So, yeah, go warn Abinander, because, yeah, Jesus of Nazareth might be under arrest. Oh, yeah, so first flashback right here, Jesus with his black swollen eyeball. His bruises and cuts, his chains, and he notices a man doing carpenter, and he's reminded of the time that he made this table for his mother, talking about how he's going to make a tall table where you sit upright, and him and his mom. Oh, mother, he's a big old mama's boy. It's very sweet. And they laugh, they splash water, he gives her a little kiss. Oh. Also, the cool thing about Jesus is he has this, this is one of the first times where I realized, like, not only is computer animated violence, like, the wave of the future, but just little augmentations. A lot of them you don't even notice, but one that you probably do notice is Jesus' eyes. They are given this supernatural, like, hazel glow. So it's pretty neat. Anyway, everyone's there. Mom and Mary and his brother. They're all there watching Jesus get found guilty. Abinander gets the message in the middle of the night. More awesome Latin is spoken. And yeah, also great that there's no, besides Jim Caviezel and Monica Bellucci, everyone else is just some kind of rando actor, right? Again, that also adds to the realism. That adds to the authenticity of everything when you're not recognizing people. That's why Superman always works best when he's played by a nobody. Batman should be played by a famous person, like a celebrity, because Bruce Wayne is a celebrity. Clark Kent is a loser, some rando. He should just be played by some rando brawny looking dude. So anyway, also, I've always said, you know, what was it? EVS. I always say Jesus Christ is Superman is Jesus plus Elvis. There you go. Monica Bellucci. That's a big one right there for sure. I got a buddy named Lauren. Looks just like her. I'm always shouting Monica Bellucci at her. She thinks it's cute. So, yeah, Jesus Nazarene, the troublemaker. Everyone's basically, you know, they get him to confess that he is indeed the Son of God, the King of Kings, which is the highest form of blasphemy. And he's basically going to be put to death. Or they not yet. They definitely want him. They definitely want him dead. They're going to later go to Abinander to you know, basically demand that he be crucified, not just executed, but, you know, crucified, which we all know. We all know what that is. What does he say? He says, with a big smile on his face, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated." All right. All right. Rabble, rabble, rabble. Oh, yeah. This reaction's so great. He's so upset that he literally just like rips his robe off. Now, I know this movie got a huge flack because of the way that it portrays these Jewish high priests. But I mean, Jesus, this is like how it went down, allegedly. They were pretty stubborn and dead set on persecuting the guy, allegedly, according to the story. So there you have it. Again, like the attention to detail, this production design, the set design, the cinematography, the lighting, the color palettes, the music, the score, the Foley, the dialogue, every single thing about this movie is ace, ace. Now I understand, I don't know, there might be this, kind of hokiness about the film. Kind of reminds me of Hacksaw Ridge. Hacksaw Ridge has this like almost like Hallmark movie quality to it in the first half of the film, but it kind of makes up for it because the second half of the movie is so violent. I think the same thing's going on here. You kind of have to ham up the acting and the emotional stuff, the cheesiness. You kind of have to make it seem like almost like a stage play. Yeah. Like overacting a little bit, really telegraphing, because when we are experiencing the hellish violence of the second half of this movie, I think you'll be grateful that some of these scenes were a little more I don't know, old Hollywood. Tearing your clothes off, says Adam Gray, is serious shit for the Jewish. Yeah, I think most people seem like a nice robe. I don't, you know, you don't want to lose your robe. Let's see here. You heard him. The verdict is he's guilty. These ladies, all these random people are all upset at him too. And Judas, he feels very bad. He's got these like chapped lips. His lips starting to look all cracked and dry. One of the many, many torments of him. Oh my God. We got to get this guy. Also, the extras in this movie are fantastic. I don't know where Mel Gibson found these people, but every one of these guys and girls adds such flavor to the scenery. Look at this character right here. All right. That guy got his 5 minutes of fame right there, okay? I mean, you got teeth like that, you know, we don't need to, you know, get crazy dentures or anything. We're just going to film you as is. They probably, those are his clothes probably. I'm sorry. So over the top. I love it. Judas is very sad. I'm hoping you guys could have heard that. In case you didn't hear the laugh, let's hear it one more time. Just in case. He's really enjoying the show of watching Jesus get punched in the face. Not cool. Not cool, man. All right, so yeah, Kepha feels very he feels very bad, and yeah, this is the part where he denies Jesus three times. Three people in the crowd say, "Hey, I know this guy. He hangs out with Jesus. He's one of his men." "No, I don't know him." And they even say, "You're Peter. I know you by name." He's like, "No, I'm not him." And as soon as he says it the third time, Jesus looks right at him. "I swear, I don't know the man." Third time. Peter, he looks right at the guy. He looks right at him. And Peter freaks out because he remembers he wasn't even thinking. But Jesus told him earlier, flashback, "I'll follow you forever." And Jesus is like, by the time the cock crows, you'll have denied me three times. And you know, Peter thought that was pretty weird that he said that last night. But Jesus, he was right. He is literally a prophet. Yeah, it's like some David Blaine mind freak shit going on here, man. And yeah, that would freak you out. Peter, ashamed, runs away. Also, this guy, I don't know who this actor is, but he's fantastic. I don't know what he's done since or what he's been in. I don't know. To me, he's just Peter from The Passion of the Christ. The dude needs a Cadbury egg or something. Honestly, those Cadbury cream eggs, man, I'd say they're like crack, but really you can only eat one. I mean, you just eat one real quick in one bout, one bite, and then you just swallow it down, and then you fight off like a sugar headache. I don't know. Those Cadbury eggs are insane, though. I love them. The chocolate cream eggs are awesome, too. But also, I do like those little eggs with the hard candy shell. Those are great. Now, I know the Cadbury chocolate has taken a nosedive, but it used to be amazing. It used to be my favorite. Cadbury. The Caramellos. But yeah, I don't know. I got English people in the chat, so I know they listen to way... They eat way better chocolate. I'm sure of it. I've gotten some of the Swiss chocolate from Switzerland, so that stuff's good. CLS Studio, bro, they are great, especially with milk. Well, yeah, I mean, most chocolate. Disgusting, not a fan? Are you more of like a sour nerd rope cap guy, DJ Play Nice? Are you talking about how it's disgusting that we're talking about Jesus on Easter? Anyway, Peter runs away, embarrassed and shamed. And yeah, basically with tears in his eyes, like, holy crap, guys, Jesus is legit. He's the real deal. I denied him and I am sorry. Runs away. Jesus is taken into custody, and Judas tries to, I don't know, make things right. Give back his silver, ask for his friend to get released. It's not going to happen. It's the gushy Cadbury stuff. Can't do it. Yeah, definitely something happened recently a few years ago where the texture of the chocolate changed. It seems like it's floppier. I don't know how to describe it. It's just not as, doesn't have that bite to it that it used to. It has this like kind of syntheticness about it. Still tastes the same per se. But yeah, the mouthfeel is strange. They're probably just using shittier oil, you know, cheaper fat, you know, some kind of seed oil. Who knows? Soybean oil, something we're not supposed to be eating large quantities of. I heard that eating a fucking pack of French fries these days, they keep using shittier and cheaper oil to cook food in, especially at fast food places. So like if you're getting French fries nowadays, yeah, apparently it's the equivalent of smoking a pack of cigarettes, which I don't really believe, but who knows? I'm one of those guys where I'd rather get two burgers than a burger and fries and a Coke. I'd rather get two burgers and a glass of water. call me crazy. Adam Gray, milk chocolate is nasty once you go dark. I don't like it too dark. I like to go a little half and half. Take some dark chocolate and mix it with sweetened condensed milk. Stupenzo, all my friends and family say this movie is not horror, by the way. You saying that because the blood is intense or something? Just curious. Oh, well, I kind of am joking when I say it's a horror film. But no, it is definitely more violent than most horror films you've seen, for sure. American food equals, I'm imagining that's a poop emoji or something. Black lives or black knives. Glad you're here. I keep catching your name on all these Comics Gate live streams I'm listening to. Keep hearing you. Yeah, you big baller. Professor R2, not a big fry guy, except from Five Guys. Oh, yeah. Five Guys fries are out of this world. Five Guys right now will break the bank. I mean, they were pricey before the before times. Now they're just like, yeah. I mean, it's okay that it's pricey, though, because you eat Five Guys and you definitely go into a food coma. Like they just fill your bag with fries and the burger with everything. It's insane. It definitely gives you the itis. I'm the same, bro. Burger and H2O. Yeah. I only drink like sodas. I don't know. I'll drink half of a soda, split it with mother. I'll put half a soda in my alcoholic beverages. Sometimes, most of the time I'm just drinking tonic water and shit like that. Black lives welcome. Yes, glad you're here. So yeah, stay away from that fast food, guys. it's because the thing about fast food is it used to be cheap and shitty. Now it's just shitty and expensive. So what the fuck's the point of eating there? Yeah, you know, I mean, it's no different than me eating from the frozen food section at this point. Literally, I could just take the fish sticks from my freezer and that'll basically be the same thing as a McDonald's, you know, fish sandwich. I could take those frozen, pre-made, pre-dried, freeze-dried burger patties, you know, those freezer safe French fries that you cook in the oven. It's literally the same shit as McDonald's right now. Black lives are black knives. Getting all the love. Adam Gray, fast food fries are trash. I'd rather have two sandwiches indeed. Who else has some good fries? I haven't eaten there in a long, long time, but KFC, those potato wedges are pretty badass. Oh, and Popeyes. Popeyes has great fries. I just started getting those recently. It's one of those things where I kind of forgot they had fries. And, you know, you go get that Popeyes chicken fries, that fried chicken sandwich, spicy. Or blackened spicy. Those are good, too. But the Popeyes chicken sandwich rocks. And I don't know. You get... they have the mac and cheese and the rice and beans and the mashed potatoes and Cajun gravy, but I just kind of noticed the fries and now they're my favorite side over there. I try not to get Popeyes too much, but God damn it. It's one of the few fast food places that's still slapping. Taco Bell. They're pretty much the same shit forever and ever. I mean, granted, it's like $10 to get a few tacos at Taco Bell. It used to be like, dude, $30. That was like the Comics Gate, the Jack Show food challenge, right? Eat first person to eat $30 worth of Taco Bell. $30 worth of Taco Bell. Right now, that's probably a few items. $30 worth of Taco Bell 5 years ago. Holy shit. You're talking like two or three bags worth of food. And keep in mind the $30 can't go to drinks or any of that shit. It has to be food. So yeah. I guess what I would do is get those little something with just like a lot of I don't know, rice, beans, and cheese, they fill you up too fast, you know? Do they have some kind of... I'd get, like, the grilled steak burrito. That's overpriced. Get, like, the overpriced crap. There you go. Stuff with steak on it. Yeah. I don't know. I go to Taco Bell and get those rice and bean burritos and those little chicken fucking enchilada burrito or whatever the hell they have. You get, like, three of those, and that's plenty of food. Plenty of food. I think because, like, those things are, like, 89 cents, a dollar this, a dollar that, people are like, well, I'll just get 10 of them. No, just get three or four or five tops. Two is probably not enough. Three is probably the magic number. Anyway, back to Jesus. glad you all are here on this wonderful Sunday night. By the way, I'll see you all in about 12 and a half hours on this channel when we talk about Godzilla. It's going to be fun. And I may stay up all night and edit. Who knows? A large cheese pizza from Pizza Hut is $30 delivered now in Southern California, and it's inedible. Yeah. Ain't that some shit? I remember I would go so hard on those Pizza Hut meat lovers. Dude, the Big New Yorker. I know they say the Big New Yorker is back. I'm sure it's totally different. But when I was a kid, I'm talking like middle school, I would put down one of those Big New Yorkers like practically by myself, and I would cover it in Louisiana hot sauce, and I would just have this Big New Yorker pizza, bottle of hot sauce, and like a pitcher of water, and I would just watch movies all night. It was awesome. Oh, the old Hollywood videos days. Blockbuster video, written stuff. Let's see here. What else is going on? No emails yet. That's the other thing I'm waiting on. I'm waiting on people to be like, hey, I need you to edit this poster right now. Okay. So Judas is not going to get his refund, basically, and he has to live with the sin of betraying Jesus. And spoilers, he's not going to live much longer. The guilt will be too much, especially since he's being tormented by these little demon children. You're saying, well, these children don't look like demons. They look like normal little Israeli kids. Or where are they? Would they be considered Nazarenes, Nazarethians? I don't know. Leave me alone. He's covered in sores and his lips are all chapped. Like I think he's like scratching at his face, causing these scrapes and wounds, picking at his mouth. And he calls them little devils, which is a curse word. Oh, you're cursing, eh? Ah, you shouldn't be cursing. And he grabs this kid Look at this little. Who is that? It's Rip Torn. Judas is obviously freaked out. little demons with their freaky eyes and teeth. Yeah, and then they start tormenting him, chasing him, and that's kind of the last we see of Judas for a while. Meanwhile, they go to the Virgin Mary, Mother Mary. She is listening for her son, who's directly under her in a dungeon. And now the sun has risen, and this is Jesus's last day, and Judas is being tormented by a gaggle of demon children who are chasing him up the hill, and basically in the throes of this devilish plague, he decides to put an end to all this. And the sound stops. The children are gone. He opens his eyes. And what does he see? Right behind him is a fucking dead donkey. Filled with flies. And this is where he realizes that, yes, he is damned eternally. So what does he do? He takes the bridle off the donkey and hangs himself with it. It's fucking hardcore, guys. Okay? Now, again, we are back to the Romans, Abinander, who is being told by his wife not to condemn this man. She's a believer, basically. She's heard tale of his miracles, you know, bringing sight to the blind and feeding the poor, all that stuff. The fish and the bread, all that cool stuff he did. Now, again, the sets. I don't know. I assume this is a set, right? Or did they film this on location in some historical ruins? I mean, either way, it just looks fantastic. I'm going to say leaning more towards historical ruins because of how fantastic it looks. But then again, what historical ruins are this? I need to know. I mean, I could obviously look this up, but I did the stream kind of impromptu. So I didn't do any kind of trivia reading. I think I read all the trivia about this movie years ago. I had the DVD, listened to the commentary tracks. Yeah. So basically these assholes are, you know, demanding Jesus be crucified. Abinander needs to hear a reason why. And, I don't know. Oh yeah. Jesus sees like a freaky, slow motion bird. What's it? It's like another little sign, from the heavens. While these people are arguing, you've got cool, creepy eye patch guy in the background. Yep. All these priests basically saying, look, his highest crime is he claims he's the Messiah. So he needs to be killed. He's basically a blasphemer saying that he's the king promised to the Jews. He has forbidden his followers to pay tribute to the emperor council. You have to understand Jesus, like I said in the beginning pre-show scene, Jesus did trash the market. He's kind of a rebel. You know, he's been causing problems. So they really just want to get rid of him. Abinander doesn't want anything to do with it. He says, take him to Pontius Pilate and they'll see to him. But also he has to encounter him. He has to do a little one-on-one job interview type thing. It's like, yo, what's the deal, man? Why do these guys hate you so much? He's like, look, I'm basically Jesus. I'm the son of the God. I'm the king of all kings. All right. It's pretty cool. There they are. There's his family. They're very upset in the shadows, wondering what's happening next. Look, I haven't heard anything. All right. I've questioned this guy. I find no cause to kill him. All right. Take him to Pontius Pilate. This man's Galilean. So he's King Herod's subject. Take him over there. King Herod. This guy's great, too. Hanging out with random giant cats and a bunch of whores everywhere. Barbara, happy Easter to you, too. Glad you guys can make it for a minute. So this guy is basically giving off vibes of Boy George from, what's it? Chameleon. No. What Culture Club. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, everyone's drunk, having a party. Everyone's having a nice get-together. And I don't know. This guy doesn't want to have to work right now, basically. So he has a laugh. He's basically, he's not taking anything seriously. I'm not going to condemn this guy. So they bring him back to Abinander. And they're like demanding he be crucified. And they're saying, dude, this is ridiculous. Look, here's your choice. You can either kill Jesus or the famous killer Barabbas. And dude, this guy who plays Barabbas looks awesome. I don't know if he's like a wrestler in real life or something. He's got like a milky eye. He's a freaky guy. He's like a true criminal, a plague to the city. He should be probably put to death. But they decide to free him. They would rather free Barabbas than free Jesus. And he literally has to come ask them again. Like, hey, come on, dude. Seriously, this is not a joke. Who do you want free? And they say, free Barabbas, free Barabbas. And Barabbas is all happy. Look how fucked up he is. What a charmer. Abinander can't believe his damn eyes. He lets him go. And there's this wonderful moment where Barabbas makes eye contact with Jesus. And he kind of feels bad for just a second. Herod basically wanted to see Jesus because he thought he would do miracles like they were party tricks. Right. He's asking to, you know, turn the water into the wine and all the stuff he heard. You're right. Adam Gray, Christ's balloon animals are legendary. Oh, I believe it. I mean, the fact that he even had balloons was a miracle. Celebrating the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ into the kingdom of heaven by watching his betrayal and torturous death. Cool. Well, yeah. Like I said, I feel like a lot of people just haven't seen this movie. And I don't think they give it enough credit, because it is a good movie. And like I said, I feel like a lot of people who are kind of too timid or too squeamish to watch this movie, which rightfully so. Yeah, let's just watch this abridged version on the channel. But as far as like a filmmaking aspect, yeah, this movie is, I don't know. I don't see any more historical movies that capture the vibe as well as this one does. And I really attribute most of that to the authentic languages. This movie really changed the way I look at like movies with subtitles. I realized like, oh my God, it's so much cooler to watch these movies in foreign language. I get it now. There are certain animes that I grew up watching, the English dub. So it's weird watching them Japanese. Like watching the Japanese version of Akira is strange to me. Even watching the new English dub is strange. I can only watch the old VHS dub. It's the one I'm used to. Perfect Blue. I prefer the English version. I think it's because I just grew up watching that one. But for the most part, I enjoy Japanese versions. Tokyo Godfathers is much better Japanese. Jesus Christ will be back to kick my ass in 3 days. Yes. And even cooler, Kung Fu Jesus. Yeah, I'd imagine Jesus could kick ass if he wanted to, but he doesn't need to. He's like Neo in The Matrix. He just stops the bullets with his mind. So again, we've got awesome Abinander here, just being just totally blown away. Totally blown away. Doesn't get it. So he says, hey, see to it that the punishment is severe, but don't kill this guy. And this is where we get into the scene where I'm going to describe what happened when I saw this movie in the theaters. Okay, so I'm setting the stage here. It's a packed house full of a bunch of families on Ash Wednesday. They're all wearing their church garb. They got the ashes on their foreheads. Everyone was all excited when this movie started. We're going to the movies on Wednesday. Yay, it's a school night. We're staying up late. That was kind of the vibe in the theater. By this part of the movie, you know, it's pretty hardcore. And these actors, all these extras, all these Roman guards are so fantastic. They really sell it. They all speak Latin. They all have bad teeth and grizzled faces. And they're all just so callous, joking and laughing. And this dude running the show, he's also fantastic. They all speak this wonderful Latin. Just makes everything so much more authentico. These two are the two assholes you hate the most. They're enjoying their work too much. It's a little weird. So weird. I mean, whatever. They're close, I guess. Employee relationships. I don't know. Your work buddies. I don't know. Seems a little weird. So yeah, they're going to start whipping Jesus with sticks. And, this is, not too violent, but definitely just a little taste of things to come. Yo, take on the greatest story ever written and told is an incredible feat in itself. To produce a movie like this and pull it off, in my opinion, is a miracle. Yeah, this was the highest grossing rated R film of all time, especially when you adjust for inflation. I'm on the Roman infantry dental plan myself, says Adam Gray. It's his work wife, says Barbara. Yes. boy. Yeah. And you know, these blood stained, concrete pillars that he's getting chained to, you know, you kind of understand this is not a good place where good things happen. And yeah, they basically start beating him with little, rods. And I remember this dude right here with this line right here. Oh, boy. Let's play some music, he's saying. Not cool. This guy, I think he's the one that counts. This movie's good if you want to learn how to count in Latin. But yeah, they're like stretching. And yeah, my heart is ready. And I hope you guys are ready, too, because this is where shit... Totally, at the hour mark, right at the 59-minute mark, this movie just starts doing its thing. And keep in mind, this is like very, very tame. So they start whipping him with sticks. And it's, I'm not going to show any of it too much. I don't know. They're just beating him. And you get these great, like, little, these CGI welts, like, showing up on his body. And what they did with the makeup, especially later, they put him in like this full body prosthesis suit. And then using digital effects, they like erase the makeup, the gore, and make it look like regular skin. And as they start whipping him with like the chains, they start digitally erasing that stuff so you can see the actual makeup. And I got to tell you guys, like this stuff was bad. Everyone was like, ooh, freaking out, making these kind of faces in the theater. Kind of like, damn, dude, this is hardcore. We have no idea what's about to happen, okay? Like, they're beating with sticks. I thought this was going to be pretty much it. I thought they were just going to beat him with sticks. Like, I always heard they whipped him. I'd never heard this story about them whipping him with hooks on chains. And they beat him. I think they hit him, like, 50 times. And, of course, the devil's watching. Devil's in the background, just being all spooky, slow motion. It's just... I don't know. Everything about this movie, he's got his little demon nail. Such great attention to detail. Every frame a painting. A disgusting, depraved painting sometimes. But yeah, again, my favorite incarnation of the devil. Yes, it does absolutely get worse, Adam. And in fact, we're just getting warmed up. I'll give you an example of like the kind of makeup here we got. Vigente Novi 29, 30. Ooh, like you see how they like mark him on the hip? Like we watched all those welts like appear out of nowhere on his back. His back was clean earlier at the beginning of the scene. And again, there's like, hey, all right, stop. They still want more. They want more. They demand more. He stands up. He's not taking, I don't know. It's like he must take the licking. So he stands up. And basically knows that there's more brutal stuff coming. They have these clubs with spikes. Thank God they don't use these. Instead, they're going to use the chains. And this shit, 40 lashes from a scourge was considered death sentence in itself. Yeah, of course. Like, how the hell would you survive this? You would definitely die, if not, you know, immediately after a few days later, weeks later from infections. There's no way you would heal from this back then. There's no antibiotics. There's nothing like that, right? So, yeah, you're right. Total death sentence. And, yeah, again, these guys, these guards, like, rubbing the shit in his face is super hardcore. Gusta, you like this? do you like that? It's like, dude, and this is his mother watching. This is hardcore. And I think everyone in the theater at this point is like making this face like, holy God, is this what we're about to watch? Is this seriously where this movie's going? And I tell you guys, like I said, I have never to this day seen a theater react to a movie like I did this movie. This movie changed my life. Okay. The theater was, I'm not joking, like full throated screaming. Okay. Professor R2, the scourge was a leather whip, often with metal weights and sharp pottery shards attached so it would rip flesh. Yeah. Okay. So again, biblically, the literal Bible story of Jesus getting whipped. I have to warn you guys now. Like I said, I told you this is digital special effects, and this really blew me away because I think this is the first time I saw this utilized successfully. And I realized, like, oh my God, like the movies in the future are going to be so much more violent. He's like showing off his chains. Oh boy. I'm literally freaked out right now trying to watch this. Let's see here. He gives his mom a look saying, I'm ready. Don't worry about me, subconsciously. And yeah, dude, this first one, this is where everyone's wife noped out, R2. This is where everyone started noping out right here. Yikes! Holy shit, dude. And they do that like 30 or 40 more times. It is overkill. And I'm just going to skip ahead. They just start whipping the shit out of him, tearing out chunks of flesh out of his back. And I swear to Christ, dude, my knees were up in my face when I was watching this by myself in a packed theater. I was like covering my mouth and like screaming into my hands. I was like blown away. And then I started looking around me, like right around this part when they start like ripping his sides out and taunting him. I look around me and I realize there are like those little girls I was talking about. They are like standing up and sprinting out of the theater while sobbing hysterically. Like people were rushing out of the theater like there was a gunman in here, dude. It was insane. And that's when I realized, like, dude, this is going to be one of the biggest movie events of the year. Okay. Because I, to this day, have never seen a theater react to a movie like this. It was unbelievable. And what's fucked up is it just keeps going from here, folks. It just keeps going. They beat the Christ out of him. They whip him until he's just, a horrific bloody mess. And, they do some very tasteful stuff, you know, focusing on Mary as we hear the counting in Latin. And again, slow motion in the music. It's all epic. But again, these Romans, they really sell it with how much joy they get out of it. And all they can do is sit back and cry. Because like you said, R2, he's probably not going to survive this. And Abinander's wife shows up with the towels, the rags, to tend to Jesus' wounds. And he's been whipped, flayed all up on the back. And this guy, it was at this point that, I'm kind of doing three things at once. So yeah, they whipped him silly is what I meant to say. Sorry, Barbara. But when he starts telling them to flip him over and they start like unhooking one hand, I swear, dude, the theater started begging, like screaming at the screen, please, no. Oh my God, no, please don't do that. No more. And no, they keep whipping him again. And you're watching like his torso getting torn up in real time. It is so disgusting. And then before you even have time to process what you're watching, you see this shit. This is the creepiest devil I've ever seen. The devil's watching with this weird smile on her face, and she's cradling this demonic baby that has hairy back and arms. It's like a midget old lady. I don't even know. It's just trippy and weird and crazy. And it's right around here where people are probably walking out to the theater, to the Texas, to the box office saying, hey, I want my money back. I don't want to see this anymore. This is, if you haven't done it by now, you're probably in for the long run. But honestly, I do commend the film for starting it off like kind of light, then going super heavy. And then and that everything after this, like the big walking, the walking with carrying the cross and all that stuff, that is hard to watch too. But it's not nearly as hardcore as this stuff. So I think the fact that we kind of just get all the real bloody shit out of the way right now. I'm getting like kind of like dizzy and drained just watching this, you know, stills of it. Like it's so hardcore, guys. And yeah, they're just beating him. And like Jesus seeing his, these Romans, like their ankles stained in his blood, you know, it is insane. And of course he's again, very good use for levity, peppering levity into the movie. So it's not just 100% gore porn. In these flashbacks, and the flashbacks are poignant and they are relevant to what's happening, you know, and they're a nice, like little quick way to talk about some of his teachings and miracles. But yeah, the foot washing reminds him of the old foot washing. You know, wash, you know, take care of your man, take care of your brother, take care of your fellow man. If you don't, you know, it's like you didn't take care of me. If you take care of your friend, it's like you took care of me. Sympathy for the devil intensifies. Lofty face reveal. I don't know who you're talking about. One of those guards, maybe. Yeah. So anyway, he's pretty much sprayed all over the floor. And yeah, Abinander's second in command is shocked at what he has seen. The foot washing was just a day before, says R2. Awesome. Yeah, good to know. Yeah, Abinander totally blown away. He was hanging with his crew, having a nice meal, and then this. Yeah, the Last Supper. Ah, well, I'll be damned. So Abinander basically gives these guys a stern talking to. It's like, hey, you guys kind of went overboard here. And, you know, again, it's like too little, too late. I'm sorry. Sorry about that. I hope he gets better. I don't know, guys. He's got his fucking ribs showing right there. You can see his ribs. It's bad. And then they drag his bloody ass out of there. And it's just this hardcore, just this still alone. Like if I was to tell someone, hey, you know, the Passion of the Christ, I heard it's bloody. It's like, well, here's like one of the one frame from the movie to kind of give you guys an idea. And yeah, Mary, the two Marys show up and start soaking up all this blood. And the idea that it's like puddled in these concrete tiles, it's bad. And then, of course, yeah, they put the thorn of crowns on him. They put the cloak on him. They laugh in his face. They slap him around. Mary remembers, you know, when Jesus told these priests to stop throwing rocks at her. And that's the other thing. Jesus is portrayed as a superhero in this movie. He has this otherworldliness about him. Like I said, with his glowing eyes and just he's always moving in slow motion. He's always this grandiose figure. And yeah, Jim Caviezel's prosthetic nose really looks great. Even in like these HD transfers, like a lot of times you watch these older movies with like heavy makeup on some of the main characters. And then you watch like the Blu-ray transfer and it's like Walter Cronkite when they switch to digital. Like you can see all the makeup caked all over him. It looks terrible. Barbara Lawrence, it looks like something out of Saw. Yeah, I mean, that was like the big criticism of this movie. It was too violent. I mean, that's really the only criticism you can give this movie. It's like, it's so gosh darn violent. It's one of the most violent movies ever made. Why didn't he use the white male privilege to heal? Well, I mean, I remember that was the thing. Jesus was depicted in the Bible as being of pale skin and golden hair. So, you know. He should have. Lesson learned. Hey, stop throwing rocks at Mary, is what he's saying. And they all put their rocks down. Party's over. Again, just like such a great use of slow motion, a great use of music. I mean, I'm gonna put the audio on right here. God, like all this constant ethnic drumming and whistling and flutes and screaming and wailing really adds to the flair. Black lives, you need a timeout, but it was totally worth it. No, there are no timeouts here unless you start like, you know, I don't know, spamming the chat. Everyone here has got a wrench, right? Except R2. I'll have to give R2 a wrench later. I'll have to give Gooch a wrench. I'm trying to wrench up anyone in the chat. I'll wrench you all after the stream's over. So anyway, yeah, we're about halfway through the movie. So about halfway through the stream, I'm saying. Actually, I don't think we need to obsess over the second half of the movie as much as the first half, because the second of the half does literally and figuratively drag. It is grueling. It's a grueling watch, guys. The second half of this movie is like you're going up that hill with Jesus. It is a daunting task to make it to this film, especially in one solid sitting with no breaks or pauses. Like I said, dude, this movie, you feel exhausted when it's over. In a good way. I mean, very few movies can make you feel like this, you know, like those Jackass movies. Those Jackass movies, as stupid as they are some kind of meta, like high art, because what they are designed to do is invoke an emotion, and they show you a little vignette and that emotion is evoked. Usually that emotion is disgust or bewilderment or laughter, whatever. But the point is, it's these little like emotional proddings that the movie does to you. It basically controls you. And, oh, I should be able to make people moderators right here. Huh? I'll look into it in a minute. Says Adam. Okay. But yeah, this movie's kind of similar to, you know, I'm not going to say this movie's similar to the Jackass movies, but is, you know, similar to the Jackass movies or RoboCop. These movies like know how to control your emotions. This movie knows how to. Everything you're feeling when you're watching this movie is by design. I remember there was an intermission for this movie. It was so powerful and long. That's what's funny is this movie isn't that long. It's 2 hours. It's a nice solid runtime. But yeah, it feels long. It feels like 4 hours. And most of the length, like this first half of the movie doesn't feel this long. The first half of the movie feels like 30 minutes. It's actually an hour. The second half of the movie feels like 3 or 4 hours by itself. It is very, very, it's just like a time dilation going on here with the movie. And the movie does take its time. That time Jesus rode the grocery cart downhill was awesome. Black lives. You need someone who cares. Someone that answers your prayers. You know, your own personal Jesus, your own personal Jesus. Anyway, that was a little off. Yeah. Jesus looking majestic as hell. Jim Caviezel. Now we all know that he got struck by lightning and almost died multiple times making this movie. We all know that this man is a man of faith. He didn't take this job. He took this job very seriously. He did all the research. He's a devout man of God. So, yeah, I mean, that was noble of him. It's good that, you know, he walks the walk, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. And that was the other thing about this movie. Everyone involved in it seemed to walk the walk. That's what I'm saying. Like, it's easy to think this movie might be blasphemous or, I don't know, tasteless. But it's actually quite the opposite. I think this movie is pretty skillfully and masterfully done. And yeah, I joke, say it's one of my favorite horror movies of all time. That is a joke, but it is one of my favorite movies of all time. That is not a joke. And mostly just because, like I said, it's a master filmmaking, master storytelling, even though those feelings are, you know, feelings of horrific hauntedness, this movie makes you feel a certain way. And Mary Magdalene, right? Basically looking up to the man. They spit wine in his face. They basically are treating him like a piece of meat, like a piece of shit. It's awful. And Abinander cannot believe his eyes. He is definitely taken aback. I think most people are taken aback. They are pretty shocked. Like they said, he's probably going to die just from this flailing. Green Goblin wore it better, says Adam Gray. Adam needs his own timeout. No, nobody gets timed out. We're all in it together, folks. But yeah, everyone's shocked. They can't believe their eyes. And yeah, I think this is enough, right? This is enough punishment. No, we want him crucified. And he says, look, I've got the power to crucify you or else to set you free. And he just says, do what you got to do, man. You have no power over me except what is given to you from above. Therefore, it is he who delivered me to you. So the Roman governor didn't want to put him to death because his wife had a dream about him the night before. Yes, they did show that in the movie. She is, you know, awakened when Abinander gets the message that he's been arrested. He basically realizes he's got to do what he's got to do. Otherwise, there's going to be a riot. You know, there's going to be a clash. So he's washed his hands clean and he says, look, it's on you guys. All right. So you do with him what you will. But, you know, his blood is off my hands. And Jesus, watching Abinander wash his hands, is once again reminded of the Last Supper, like R2 said. Washing his hands, talking about the bread, talking about the wine, talking about his body, his blood, all that good stuff. All that good stuff. When was the last time you guys had communion? Abinander, not going to do it. It's not up to me. You guys do what you want. Adam Gray, we want a pinata. That is very Catholic on brand. They do like pinatas. That's not a Jesus thing, is it? Where do pinatas come from? That can't be. No, don't ruin pinatas for me. Pinatas are about candy and stuff, right? But then again, so is Easter. Starting to see a connection here. A connection I don't want to see. Stay in full screen, damn you. Anyway, let's start walking this cross. You've got these other, the two thieves, right? They're going to be accompanying Jesus. And Jesus gets this gigantic, heavy, single piece of wood, this huge cross. And Jesus, asking for strength. And so begins the huge, arduous journey of walking up the hill. Everyone in town beating the shit out of him. His eyeball, it just looks amazing. Just this frame alone, like, again, every frame of painting, not necessarily a painting you want to look at, but still, Jesus remembering when he was, the same people that are beating him, welcoming him into his town when he rode in on the donkey, the golden sun. Again, it's very tasteful. These flashbacks. They're quick, but they say so much. Like, that flashback was a couple frames, you know? It's like, how many seconds is this? 1, 2, 3, 3-second clip. You say so much with that. And again, Mary, this is an awesome scene right here. Mary, Jesus's mother, watching, and she is the only person that sees the devil in the entire movie. The devil makes eye contact with her. Creepy stuff, dude. Great, great filmmaking. Just taking these stories and just really, just putting them to the camera, you know. Professor R2, the juxtaposition of the triumphal entry and the crowd mocking him is so powerful. Indeed, Gooch, this is tough to watch. Yes, it is. We're doing it together, guys. And like I said, we're going to watch the abridged version. So like I said, if you know someone who doesn't want to, subject themselves to this horrific nightmare of a film, just send the stream their way. Maybe they can learn to appreciate the movie from some kind of a distance. One of the many, many times where Jesus is going to fall down in slow motion and stumble. And each time, different people help him get up. Sometimes he has to help him get himself up. Other times we meet some other interesting characters along the way as the story continues. I think this is the moment where his mom. Oh my God, this part. This is the part where the waterworks happen. This is the part where Niagara Falls, Frankie boy. So hard to watch this and not get a little teary-eyed. Jesus falls down once again, and Mary, oh my God, get to the important stuff, please. she remembers watching her little child Jesus fall down, and how you know, you drop everything, you run. Oh boy. Let's play the music a little bit so you can get the whole the grand sweepingness of it all. You could argue it's a little hokey, but God damn it, I love it. I think it's great. I think it's very, very well done. And yeah, definitely hard to not get a little wet in the face. Get up, get on up, like a sex machine. My pal Lucifer says diabolical souls. Adam Gray nailed on the scene. Get on up, crucifix machine. You guys are funny. See, you guys are the ones doing all the blasphemy, not me. I'm being a good boy today. So yeah, let's just start breezing through this. And Jesus tells his mother, very, very, very intense. He looks at her and says, see, mother, I make all things new. And I'm going to turn the music back off. He says goodbye to his mother and continues to walk. The devil made me do it, says Gooch. No, no, no. 3 days later, I'm out on love. All right, that one caught me. All right, I'm trying not to laugh, you guys. You guys are silly. But also, I've seen this movie a dozen, two dozen, three dozen times. I don't know, a lot of times. And yeah, it's easy to, it'd be easy to be a sick-minded freak and laugh at all this. But I just don't find it funny. There's nothing funny about this, guys. Okay? So again, more Latin. God, I wish the whole movie was in Latin, honestly. But at least the guards or the Romans are bilingual. Now we've got this young lady who's going to give Jesus some water later. And yeah, let's just roll through it, guys. It's just, it's so much of the same shit. We've got this guy who is suddenly, Gooch, I'm atheist. What do you want from me? I want you to find Jesus. I want you to say, I want Jesus to save your soul. I want you to find God. No, I'm just kidding, Gooch. You just do you, buddy. So yeah, this guy, what's his name again? I can't remember. I haven't seen this in a while. He's going to help Jesus carry his cross for reasons. Because something about you're being too hard on him. You open your mouth. Oh no, Jesus is having literally can't carry the cross. That's what's happening. He's been beaten to such a point. Simon of Cyrene. See, I knew R2 was going to come in clutch. Normally I would be Googling all this stuff, but I'm kind of running the show. Any second now, Stupenzo is going to slap us across the face and say, that's for blasphemy. Now, any minute now, I'm going to get struck by lightning in the comfort of my own home, and God will be like, that's for blasphemy. Let's see. So, yeah, Simon is going to help Jesus carry the cross. He's going to help carry the burden. So, again, both of these guys are falling. Carrying this cross is heavy. It's hard. I'd imagine it's much harder for a man who's been flayed, scourged. So yeah, this lady, she's going to take the holy shroud. That's what she does. She pats his face, and this is where you get the holy shroud of whatchamacallit. It's got Jesus's imprint on it, allegedly. So yeah, more beating and kicking and punching and scraping and fighting. Yeah, Simon telling him, hey, guys, go easy on the guy. He's got a long way to go. We've got a long way to go. And, yeah, I don't care what you do to me. Just, you know, please stop. Well, you know, I got places to be. So yeah, again, help Jesus get up there. This is like the third or fourth time he's fallen down already. And, we're getting closer and closer to the top of the mountain, top of the hill. They're getting it ready. Oh boy. Still think that Simon here looks like Marky Mark. You know who I thought Simon looked kind of like was It's bothering me now. Eric Andre, that's who he reminds me of. If he could slap me all the way up here in Canada, then damn, I'm a believer. Yeah, Canada is a godless, forsaken continent, country, excuse me, province, state. It's all those things. Australia is interesting because it's a continent, an island, a state, a country, and all those things at once. It's pretty cool. Back to Jesus falling and carrying his cross. Oh boy. And this is the part where like people's patience is starting to get tested in the movie, which, you know, like I said, it's done by design. This movie is supposed to test your patience a little. And like I said, I'm skimming through this pretty quickly. But when you actually watch this, it's bad. Now he is being taken up to the top of the same mountain where he did his holy sermons. And of course, flashback to his lessons that he taught up here on the hill.
Is known le re com wa ana amel com te hebon le re com te lon le da fe com.
Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute against you. Yep, Jesus died for your sins. What about Canada? Who? We are a cesspool of heathens, says Gooch. Godforsaken Canada. Canada isn't real, folks, says Adam. All right. Yeah, Canada, unfortunately, is very real. But it's okay. People like Gooch, Vex, and all you other fine Canadians, you guys are going to have to turn that place right from the inside. Like I said at the beginning of the stream, happy Trans Visibility Day. I know people were raising a big stink that this is March 31st, happens to fall on Easter, but I honestly think Trans Visibility Day should be March 31st because it's the anniversary of The Matrix coming out, which, as we all know, is the world's greatest allegory for trans rights, The Matrix. So, yeah, I think it checks out. You know, the trans people already have a whole month and a season and a week. Let's give them a day, too, on top of that. Let's just make 2024 the year of the trans. Let's just call it even. Let's just give them this whole decade while we're at it. Fuck it. Trans awareness decade. I here support it. I only wish, says Black Lives Are Black Knives, Trans Visibility Day was on April 1st. Yeah, so close. April 1st, April Fool's Day will be GXK Day. GXK discussion day here on Tales from the Dork Side tomorrow at noon. In exactly 11 hours and 40 minutes, we will be back here talking about Godzilla on another holy weekend. I think last time, yeah, we did it directly on Christmas Day, which was insane. We talked about Godzilla for 9 hours. I don't think we're going to go that hard. I think we're doing like a 3 or 4 hour discussion about that one dumb movie that just came out. So I liked it. Don't get me wrong. It was retarded and fun. This movie was not retarded and not fun, but excellent. Still managed to be very good. Let's see. We're going to turn the audio off. Go back to clipping. Go back to screenshotting. Going up the hill. This is the part where we're going to put Jesus on the cross. We're going to put his hand with nails. Mel Gibson allegedly has a cameo as one of the dudes holding the hammer. You apparently only see his hand, which, you know, that's, I don't not believe it. Simon does his job, and now everyone's going up to see him again. Like I said, his eyes have this supernatural, like, golden glow about them that's all done in post, and it's one of the few computer effects in this movie that looks a little dodgy, but it looks dodgy, and it's good because it draws your eyes to it. It makes you realize something off about his eyes. His eyes are supernatural. We're gonna hang him up. And of course, we get, like, I think one of the final flashbacks of the Last Supper here. And he's given his wisdom as we watch him get nailed to this cross. And it is this is back to the whipping scene. Pretty hardcore. The difference is we have this very amazing music playing. I think that's Mel Gibson right there. Not joking, being serious. I think that's Mel Gibson right there. Yeesh. Again, these effects are really good. And I think the reason why they look so good is because they don't really showcase them too much. They just kind of show you enough for a few seconds. And that's really all you need. And like I said, even though this isn't technically a horror movie, Mel Gibson knows how to direct horror. I'll tell you that much. Just like Steven Spielberg. I don't think Steven Spielberg's ever made an actual horror film, but all of his movies have horror elements. And I think the same is true with Mel Gibson and his movies. Mel Gibson claims to have driven the nail himself. Might as well. Gooch, this is my blood, now drink. This is my body, now eat it. That's the scene. Yep, you got it. And that's the other thing, is we don't need to go over in painstaking detail all the stuff we already know. And we also don't need to painstakingly analyze all the stuff we don't want to see, which is all this insane violence. And heartbreak and anguish. That's the other thing. That's like even harder to watch than the violence, is the fact that his mother is watching the whole time, looking totally tortured and traumatized. And yet Jesus still has a big smile on his face almost. He knows that this is like what his whole life has led up to. This horrific, arduous journey. And, oh, yeah, they can't get one of his arms in. I remember this part. This was added, I think, or I don't know if this was in the Bible, but apparently one of his arms can't reach the other spot. So they, like, dislocate his shoulder and get his knee to get his hand to reach the other place. It's, like, so fucked up. And, of course, they put one nail through both of his feet. And, then they start hanging him up. And they accidentally drop him again. It's just, dude, it is like the Saw movies. This is torture porn to an extent, for sure. It is such a grueling watch. We're almost done, folks. And Monica Bellucci, still so gorgeous, even when she looks like shit. She's amazing. We're going to get everything wrapped up in a nice little bow as Jesus gets put up. And guess what? There's still more, folks. Jesus now has to sit here for a good 10-15 minutes while he waits to die. It's pretty bad. And he just kind of sits here and everyone kind of shows over. All right, let's go ahead and just leave him here. And the thieves are all, one thief is like, feels sorry for Jesus, is a believer. The other thief is doesn't believe in Jesus, mocks him. And the thief who, one thief says, hey, I'm sorry, Jesus, accept me. He says, hey, we'll be in paradise together. Don't worry. This guy, who's a shit talker, has a crow literally peck out his eyeball. You see what I'm saying when I say this is kind of like a horror movie, right? I mean, it's so over the top. But what's great is it's all taken directly from the Bible. So maybe the Bible is a horror novel when you think about it, or at least parts of the Old Testament are. The New Testament. Oh boy. Yeah. What are you in for? Who's going to be the first to with the, I can see your house from here. I guess that was you, Barbara. You were the one who was the first to say it. So you guys, seriously, I thought about having like a watch party for this movie, which would have been funny, but, I realized like probably not too many people were going to be interested in that. This seemed more on brand, a analytical dissection, impromptu kind of watch along. Oh, this bird is real bloody. Oh yeah. He got deep in that dude's eyeball. Now Jesus is sitting up there on the cross and the storm starts to brew. And Jesus's death is quickly approaching. And yeah, big storm shows up out of nowhere and definitely freaks people out. These guards like kind of all one by one kind of realize, this guy might be legit. And all the holdouts kind of realize right here that they might have screwed up. They might have jumped the gun. Three guys on a cross show up in a town, says Gooch. First time? Yeah. Oh, boy. Obviously, the temple priest, Jewish temple priest, they are They're very, this guy, I don't know this main dude. I don't know what his name is. I don't know what the actor's name is, but he's such a great, I mean, I guess an antagonist. Yeah. The human antagonist, I guess the actual antagonist is the devil, who kind of sits around and watches things. Mistakes were made, says Adam Gray. Yeah, I think that's what this is the part of the movie we're in right now. We're starting to get a little buyer's remorse. We shouldn't have, maybe we shouldn't have gone so heavy on the guy since he claims to be the son of God and all. What if he's telling the truth? You know, you got to entertain those things. It's like the QAnon stuff. Like, it's like, sure, it's easy to think that stuff's conspiracy theory, that everyone in Hollywood is a pedivore who worships the devil, but what if it's true? Same thing with Jesus, you know? Like, what if Jesus actually was the guy, you know? The crimes of the executed often would often be written on a sign or hung around the neck so people could see. Jesus' sign simply said he was who he said he was, King of the Jews. Yeah. Irony. Heaping dose of irony for you right there. So yeah. Needs more white hoods, says Black Lives. Some random dude in the crowd actually said that. Let's see here. Hey, I'm Jesus' mother. Let me through. Yeah, he's not doing good. She kisses him on his bloody feet. And they give him some water on a sponge, on a spear. And he finally, she says, let me die with you. He says, woman, behold your son, my brother. You know, take care of him. You know, go on without me. And son, take care of your mother. Take care of your mother, my brother. And Mary Magdalene, everyone's sad except for pecked out eye guy. He's pretty angry about the whole situation, rightfully so. But yeah, this is the big climax of the movie. Jesus asks for their forgiveness, says they don't know what they're doing. Why have you forsaken me? He dies. And we watch his eye literally dilate. It's pretty hardcore. Translation. You're the man of the house now. Take care of your mother. Indeed. Bill Shatner was behind this. I'm sure of it. Says Adam Gray. What isn't Bill Shatner behind? You know, he's behind it all. Yeah. And like, just kind of looks like he just kind of falls asleep. It's kind of crazy. And out of nowhere, lightning and a thunder. All this shit starts happening. Let's see. We get a little droplet of rain fall to the ground. And the moment it touches the ground, there's a huge earthquake. It's pretty crazy. Now, special effects of this part of the movie might be a little lacking. I'll allow it. The horses freak out. Everyone's scared shitless all of a sudden. There's a great rumbling and crumbling. Abinander feels it. Everyone feels it. Something has happened. There's a dark disturbance in the force. Yeah, and I mean, geez, I mean, you guys were looking for a sign. This is it. This is pretty much the sign right here that you might have messed up. And they kind of have to make sure he's dead. So, yeah, the one guard puts a spear in Jesus's side. And he sprays blood all over his mother. It's disturbing. Yeesh. And the Roman guard falls to his knees, shocked by what he's done. And everyone kind of sits there in silence. And the temple is in ruins from the earthquake. The priests are extremely upset. They start ripping their robes off like crazy. Parading around the streets naked. I'm just kidding. That didn't happen. We may have got a bit too far in a few places, says Black Lives or Black Knives. So, yeah. Everyone just kind of struck by the foul, evil deed they had done. And a lot of tears, a lot of dirt, a lot of remains smoldering. A lot of fear, a lot of uncertainty. Lot of new believers. And then we get the devil in his final scene. giving a big old performance here. It's just so freaking freaky. What do you mean, we, says Adam Gray? He means you, dear. That's right. I keep forgetting Black Lives is a man. So, yeah, the devil's upset for some reason, or I guess celebrating. I don't know what the devil's doing. Freaking out, acting like a maniac. And, yeah, they take down Jesus's body, and Mary looks right at the camera. And we see Jesus's crown of thorns. I remember this shot right here on the trailer, because the trailer didn't show you any of the violence. The trailer just kind of, it was all implied. Yeah, I won't ruin the illusion. Black Lives, your only fans, subscribers, your secret's safe with me. But yeah, I remember this shot right here was on the trailer. Just this like close up of this bloody rose of crown of thorns, and like that. Like that right there kind of tells you that this movie's going to be violent. I mean, there's just like it's not even red. The blood is like brown. You know what I mean? Ugh. It's very, very visceral. And yeah, the camera pans in and Mary looks right at the camera, looks right at us. Just gives us this look like, why did you do this to my son? Psh, foot washing is fine. Show a couple too many junk sinks and you're canceled. The show recreating the paella. Okay. That shot. There you go. That's right. Yeah, good stuff. And yeah, the camera just kind of slowly pans out. We see all of our characters kind of sitting around Jesus. And then we end on a real good high note. Because right now, you have to understand, in the theater, people are just, I want to say the theater was packed when the movie started. I think right around here, it was like, two-thirds full. Like, I want to say at least a third of the audience left. Like, they could not stick it out. And I don't blame them. But at the end, you get this awesome resurrection scene, which says everything you need to say in just a few seconds. You get... I don't, you know, I know this is kind of a... I don't know how it goes down in the Bible, but, you know, Jesus is in the tomb for three days. We've got the shot of the big rock moving out of the way, and it's all one take, and the camera pans through the cave, and we see these shadows moving, and I'm trying to understand how this works, like, lighting-wise, other than the fact that it just looks cool, but if only I only left to validate my parking, says Adam Gray. So we keep this this camera panning across the tomb, and we see Jesus's clothed body for just a second, and we could tell that he starts to disappear as soon as the sun touches him, and the camera pulls back a little bit farther, and there's Jesus alive and well, glowing in a holy halo. And yeah, he opens his eyes, stands up, and we see his crucifixion wound. The music's all epic, by the way. And there's a big hole in his hand, and he walks away. And that's how you end the movie. You end it on a high note, folks. And yeah, Mel Gibson, he's really a master class director. I don't think he's made a single lousy film. He goes in the tomb on day one. He is in the tomb for a day and emerges on day three, which would be Sunday. So Good Friday is the day he's killed. Correct. Saturday and Sunday. I gotcha. Makes sense. Well, guys, we talked about the Passion of the Christ, and honestly, we talked about it pretty much the exact length of the movie. How cool is that? 2 hours, 5 minute long movie, 2 hour, 5 minute long stream. I hope you guys understand that I'm not trying to take the piss. I'm not trying to be silly. I'm not trying to be edgy. I do like this movie a lot, and I know it's not for the faint of heart. I know it's not for those who are doubters. It's also probably not for those that are too religious. There's got to be like a middle ground. This movie is for the layman, the average Joe who might not be so sure about things. I don't know. Like Professor R2 says, it's a powerful and moving film, if maybe a little over the top. Well, you know, sometimes you need over the top to slap the audience in the face. You know, you need to let them know, hey, this is serious. Well, guys, it's been great talking about this movie. I am going to get back to editing for a little bit longer so I can go to bed nice and early and wake up early. I'll see you guys in about 11 and a half hours on this channel to talk about Godzilla. If anybody wants the link to that and I haven't sent it to you already, give me a shout out. I'll shoot it to you. I don't think we're going to have a full house tomorrow per se, but I have been wrong before. I'd like to thank Professor R2 first and foremost for being Mr. Historical Biblical Scholar of the stream, giving me all my correct information, telling me what's what. Adam Gray and Black Lives doing the jokes so I don't have to. Barbara keeping all of us in check, making sure we don't go out of line. Gooch representing Lucifer and the devil and all the diabolical stuff. You know, we need both sides represented. I know Lord of Toxicity was here earlier. I don't know if he's still here. Who else was here a second ago? CLS Studios was here. And DJ Play Nice, of course. Hope you get some good Easter candy tomorrow on half price. Not the crappy chocolatey stuff, the good stuff. Yes, Easter bunnies to you, beers all around to you. I honestly need a beer now. I wasn't drinking for this show, but after like kind of even just going through the cliff notes of this movie, it's like, dude, I need a smoke and a beer. I need to like, I don't know. You just get like tense in your back watching this movie. You get like a weird, like not necessarily a tummy ache. You get like a tummy tremble of some kind. I don't know. It just definitely does something to you. Sacramental wine. Yeah. I don't have any wine around the house. I'm not a big wine drinker. I do have some grapes though. I do like those a lot. And dude, I said this on one of my other streams. I have grape juice. I'm not a big grape juice fan. I got onto the organic, like 100% grape juice. It's totally different. It's totally different from that Welch's grape cocktail crap. The 100% organic grape juice is like, it tastes like liquid grape jelly. It's amazing. Barbara Lawrence, I'm an atheist, but I do appreciate the work and effort that went into this. Of course, this is such a good movie. And yeah, people joke about it. People think I'm joking when I say, you know, favorite movies, favorite horror movies, favorite scary movies. I'm always like, The Passion, it's up there, dude. People are like, what? I'm like, no, I'm being for real. Sacramento wine, not worth it, says Adam Gray. Does sparkling rosé count? Sure. Sure it does. All right, guys. Well, again, it was very, very, very fun hanging out with you on this blessed holiday and appreciating a film that I don't think too many of our cinephile fans appreciate enough. I'm going to go ahead and remove this from the screen, and I'm going to play us out with a fun little video that I will also play tomorrow for the Godzilla stream. Every day be hustling, folks, and you guys take it easy. Have a great night, and I'll see you tomorrow, bright and early, at the crack of noon. One more comment before we go. Cheers, peeps. Professor R2, see you guys later. All right, let's play us out. Here we go.
Miami, the Playboy's paradise. Pretty girls, fast cars. That's just a facade. The bridge separates South Beach from my Miami. The real Miami, the MIA. This is where we hustle.
Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Suckers think you're tripping with, yes, I'm the boss. 745, white on white, that's Rick Ross. I keep them wide, I keep them long, I keep them fat. I keep them coming back, we keep them coming back. I'm in the distribution, I'm like Atlantic. I got them pretty things flying across the Atlantic. I know Pablo Noriega, the real Noriega. He owe me 100 favors. I ain't petty player, we buy the whole thing. See,
homies hustle, they still do their thing. My roof back, my money ride. I'm on the pedal, show you what I'm running like. When they snatch black, I cry for 100 nights. He got 100 bodies, serving 100 lights.
Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day.
Steal cars, but we hard. Whip it real hard. Whip it real hard. I call the charge. I call the charge. Whip it real hard. Whip it real hard. Ain't about no funny stuff. Still flipping them chickens. I'm on my money stuff. Still whipping them Benzes. Major League. Who catching? Because I'm pitching. Jose Canseco just snitching because he finished. I feed them steroids to strengthen up all my chickens. They flying over Pacifics to be specific. Triple C's, you know it's fact. We hold it set. So big and gone rat. Run and tell them that. More cars. More old. More clothes. More clothes. More.
Every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling. Every day I'm hustling.